Priyanka, I'm Sonal Mehrotra Kapoor. Now, shock and anger swept the country when it emerged that the parents of 7-year-old Adya, who died in a dengue case in Gurugram's Fortis Hospital, were billed 16 lakhs in just 15 days of treatment. The bill also included costs of over thousands of gloves, 660 syringes, and the father also alleged that they were found to be charging them of medicines which were of a particular brand much costlier than the other variants. Now, even as the central government has asked for action in this case and warned hospitals across the country, a fresh report has come in, this time from Medanta Hospital again in Gurugram. Medanta is alleged to have billed an insurance agent rupees 15.88 lakhs for his 7-year-old son, again in a dengue case which lasted for over 22 days. The father said he has to mortgage his house and make the statement. Now, as we are discussing all of this, you know, what is really shocking is that these horror stories do not end. Reports have just now come in, again from Gurugram, of a 12th standard student who was admitted in Shiva Hospital for food poisoning. And in an unconscious state, that girl was groped by male nurses. And as we speak, we are now getting reports that a POXO Act has been enforced on these people and they have now been arrested on this case. So, today on Agenda, we are asking, is the private medical healthcare system in the country in a case of emergency? Is this, the state of healthcare in the country, something we need to discuss every day as it impacts everybody's life? And I'm very happy to have a very wide panel here with us today and very accomplished. We've got, I'm going to start with Dr. K K Aggarwal, who's the head of Indian Medical Association. With him taking questions from Medanta is Dr. Naresh Trahan. Thank you so much for coming on the program and taking the questions, sir. We'll be joined by Mr. Daljeet Singh from the Fortis Hospital. He's the president there in short while from now. We've also got Ashok Aggarwal, who's an activist, lawyer, and somebody who's crusading for the rights of the poor. In this case, we've also got Dr. K.R. Balakrishnan from Chennai, who's also from Fortis on this case. Now, I want to begin with you, Dr. Trahan. After this case really shook, baby Adya's case really shook everybody, it was quite a surprise that within days, this case has emerged from Medanta. And I'm happy that you are today here taking questions and Fortis is here to take questions. And I'm not in any way, just to clarify, saying that you are supposed to take the blame for something, for the entire medical private healthcare system. But what happened? How is this that this man now, who's an insurance agent, you know, I spoke with him and we've got him on the phone line. We'll speak with him. Let me just point out the three things that he said. He said that when he took the boy on the 9th of 29th at 11:40, he was inside Medanta. It took him 3 hours. It was not until 3 a.m. that he could even get his boy admitted in the hospital because he was asked for a security of 75,000 rupees that he just did not have. He's saying, I had 50,000, I got that money deposited, but why the delay? Wasn't an emergency patient at that point needed to be catered to firsthand directly?
First of all, he was in the emergency room and he was being given treatment. The question was whether he would want to be admitted. The basic thing was that the child was brought in a very serious condition. His BP was 80 by 60, he was what we call the dengue shock syndrome, which is and he was in renal failure, he was hepatic failure, he was having platelet counts were low, he was bleeding. So he came from another hospital where he had already suffered huge amounts of complications of dengue shock syndrome. The basic thing is that when a patient comes in, it's our duty to give them emergency care, and then so that was being given in any case. That's not that is. So admission from emergency to the ward or the ICU, it's the same thing because emergency also is like an ICU. So he was being treated. That's not the point. The basic thing is that with the child coming in the shape he was, what should the hospital do? The hospital has to do everything possible in their knowledge, in their power, to try to save the child. Shock was reversed, his liver failure improved, his kidney function improved, he had an intracerebral bleed. So you could say at any given point you could have said, you know, it's too far gone, but it's her duty, and Mazanta takes pride in giving the highest end of care. So to correct all the problems that had occurred to him, there were requirement of ventilator, there was a requirement of IVIG, which is an
which you did cater to. You're saying all emergency things and were complied by, and he was taken immediately into care.
Right.
I've heard you. I just want to bring in Shaurya's father, whom we've got on the phone line. Aapko meri awaaz aa rahi hai, sir?
मैडम आपकी आवाज आ रही है
जी. सर मेरे साथ, मैं पहले आपसे अपोलोजाइज करना चाहती हूँ. शौर्या अभी हमारे साथ नहीं है और मैं समझ सकती हूँ फैमिली के साथ क्या गुजर रहा होगा, लेकिन हमारे साथ इस समय डॉक्टर त्रिहान है जो मेदांता के हेड हैं. आप उनसे कोई सवाल पूछना चाहते हैं?
मैडम मेरे उनसे सिर्फ दो क्वेश्चन है. पहला क्वेश्चन तो ये है कि जब डॉक्टरों को सारी चीजें मालूम थी इस बच्चे के बारे में, तो इन्होंने फिर वो बच्चों के परिजन से हम लोगों से शेयर क्यों नहीं की कि बच्चा ये नहीं बच सकता? पहला क्वेश्चन. मैडम आप सुन पा रही हैं क्या मुझे?
जी मुझे बताइए. सुन रहे हैं डॉक्टर त्रिहान भी, सुन रहे हैं हम भी सुन रहे हैं. हाँ, दूसरा सवाल बताइए.
डॉक्टर साहब से मेरा निवेदन है कि जब उनके डॉक्टरों को और उनकी टीम को ये पता था सुनील सिंघी सर के कि ये बच्चा आगे सही नहीं हो सकता है या ये नहीं बच पाएगा, तो इनको बताना चाहिए था कि आपका बच्चा नहीं बच पाएगा, तो कम से कम आप पैसे इन्वेस्ट मत करो. आप गरीब आदमी हो, आपको पैसे नहीं खर्च करने चाहिए. एक चीज. और इनके डॉक्टर साहब सुनील सिंघी सर ने हमसे ये कहा था मेरे परिवारजनों के सामने कि आपका बच्चा 80% आपका बच्चा खतरे से बाहर हो चुका है. और इसी में एक क्वेश्चन ये जो है जोड़ूंगा मैडम कि जब बच्चा 80% खतरे से बाहर हो गया था, तो बच्चे की जान क्यों गई और बच्चे के अंदर इन्फेक्शन कहाँ से आया? जबकि 30 तारीख को बच्चा एडमिट हुआ है, उस दिन से लेके 8-9 तारीख तक ये बच्चे के अंदर कोई इन्फेक्शन नहीं था. और दूसरा क्वेश्चन मैडम इसी में मेरे एक आखिरी क्वेश्चन ये है
जी, पूछ
डॉक्टर प्रधान जी से कि बच्चे का जो MRI, बच्चा आपके यहाँ 30 तारीख को एडमिट होता है, सुबह 3 बजे आप ट्रीटमेंट शुरू करते हैं 3 घंटे बाद, और आप हमको 10-11 बजे बताते हैं कि बच्चे की लीवर, किडनी, लंग्स ये सब फेलियर है, BP ऑलमोस्ट 0 है. अगर डॉक्टर साहब से निवेदन है कि हम तो इस लाइन के आदमी भी नहीं है, हमें मेडिकल के बारे में कोई जानकारी नहीं है, बट जब किसी व्यक्ति का ब्लड प्रेशर या तो लो या जरूरत से अधिक हाई होता है, तो उसका सबसे पहला असर कहाँ जाता है? लीवर और किडनी पर. बस इन्होंने लीवर किडनी नहीं, माइंड पर और किडनी पर.
ठीक है गोपेंद्र जी मैं आपके सवाल समझ गई हूँ. मुझे एक क्लैरिफिकेशन चाहिए आपसे. आपने मुझसे पहले जब बात करी थी तो आपने कहा कि इमरजेंसी सर्विस जो इमिजिएटली दी जाती है, जब आप शौर्या को लेकर गए अस्पताल, उसमें डिले था 3 घंटों का. त्रिहान जी यहाँ पर कह रहे हैं कि वो ट्रीटमेंट शुरू हो गया था. क्या ये बात सच है कि बच्चे का ट्रीटमेंट शुरू हो गया था?
बच्चे के पास मैडम मैं खड़ा रहा था, बच्चा मेरे पास था, बच्चे के पास मैं खड़ा रहा. 3 बजे बच्चे को लेकर ICU तक छोड़ने मैं स्वयं गया था.
उससे पहले इमरजेंसी में तो था ना बच्चा, उसकी केयर हुई वहाँ पर?
इमरजेंसी नहीं था मैडम, मैं कह रहा हूँ कि नीचे की इनकी लॉबी है, उसी लॉबी में था सिस्टर, उसी नीचे की लॉबी में था, गेट के पास ही था बच्चा, और बच्चे को मैंने पानी भी पिलाया था, बच्चे ने मुझसे मुँह से पानी मांगा था. इनका ट्रीटमेंट जब मैंने पैसे जमा करा दिए उसके बाद.
ठीक है गोपेंद्र जी, मैं आपकी बात समझ चुकी हूँ. मैं एक डॉक्टर त्रिहान को इसमें एक देना चाहती हूँ. सर आई अंडरस्टैंड दैट सम ऑफ हिज क्वेश्चंस आर बेस्ड ऑन ट्रीटमेंट रिलेटेड एक्सेट्रा विच कैन बी अप फॉर डिबेट, आई एम नॉट गेटिंग देयर, बट ही सेज वेरी कैटेगोरिकली समथिंग आई वांट टू स्ट्रेस अपॉन. ही सेज दैट इफ द डॉक्टर्स हैड फिगर्ड आउट दैट हिज लंग हैड वॉज नॉट, हिज लिवर हैड वॉज नॉट फंक्शनिंग, हिज किडनीज वर नॉट फंक्शनिंग, वाई वॉज इन दिस पोजिशन मेड वेरी क्रिस्टल क्लियर टू हिम फर्स्ट अप दैट लिसन दीज आर द चांसेस and this is the money it will cost. He is saying he was under the impression that the child is 80% okay.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
One second. Let's put it in perspective.
Okay.
First thing first, the kid came in a very bad shape. Is the doctor supposed to try to save him or not save him? We tried to save him and we actually got him better in those 22 days. His liver function recovered, his kidney function recovered, his neurological status has recovered. So there you can only say they did a remarkable job of taking a situation which the patient's father is saying himself. From there to bring him up to this level was a humongous job and done well by the doctor. So they should be actually appreciated for it, that they were able to bring it out. Now, if A doctor's job is not to sit in judgment, but doctor's job is to not give up till the last moment. Hundreds of people are saved in this situation. And the child actually improved quite a bit. That's when the family decided to take him to another hospital. The patient did not die in Medanta. The patient expired in another hospital. It's a very sorry thing to happen. And our sympathies are with the family that we lost the child. We also worked very hard. Our teams worked very hard. We brought it to a stage where from a very low stage, he was already at a stage when Dr. Singhi said, who is the chief of the pediatric division, and he said that 80% we have recovered and 20% is still to go, because he had even a brain bleed. Everything else had recovered, but the brain would take some time to recover.
You're making a very interesting point, sir, where you say that the doctor does not give up to the last minute. But how do you make that picture clear to somebody who does not have the knowledge of that? I'll come to that.
Let me respond to it. No,
I'll
please, because you must be, you cannot put it out of perspective. Every day, three times, four times a day, the family was counseled. Every penny was explained to them. The next step was explained to them, how much is going to cost. Only then, and there are consents for it. For every treatment, there is a consent.
Correct.
So, in the grief, if you forget, maybe it's one of those things that slips the mind at this point. The record shows that every procedure that was done, the consent was taken. There were several consultants working on it.
Okay, important point there. Important point there.
The liver people, the kidney people, the brain people, the respiratory people, and the pediatrician. So there are five specialists who work day and night to try to save
the child.
Take
your point. I
want to,
at this point, introduce Mr. Daljeet Singh from Portis. Thank you so much for coming today, sir,
and
taking this.
Let me add one more thing.
Let me introduce other panelists, sir. So a similar case, and in fact a more shocking one, came from Fortis a couple of days back, where the bills have been all over. People are underlining those, highlighting that it's all over social media, asking why so many gloves were required, why so many syringes were required. I'm not getting into the technicality. I want to ask from you today, as a responsible healthcare partner or somebody working on this in the country, how are you taking this forward? I understand today now the case has been filed, an inquiry has also been filed by the Haryana court. Even the central government is taking onus and, you know, asking you some tough questions. What are you going to do now?
Well, I think I just want to make one thing very, very clear here. Having also heard what Dr. Trehan had to say about this case, clinically there was nothing that was actually left to chance. Every single procedure, every single treatment was done to the best abilities of the finest doctors that India has to offer. So there's no treatment protocol that has actually been carried out on this child that was not recommended.
But the billing is being questioned here, not the line of treatment. The billing is being questioned here.
So the billing, you spoke about gloves, you spoke about syringes. Madam, I just want to make it very clear out here, as well as to the viewers, that on an average day in the ICU, especially in a pediatric ICU, there are 50 to 60 pairs of gloves that are actually used, because
on one patient.
Please have a look. You know, I think people need to get sensitized to the fact that what does it take to treat patients and what does it take to manage infection control in hospitals. One of the biggest dangers we have in hospitals is what is called the hospital acquired infections, and we are paranoid about ensuring that this infection actually doesn't transmit to the patient. Our aim is to get the patient well and get them out of the ICU and out of the hospital in the minimum possible time. Because it's not a hotel where people just stay on.
All right. I want to bring in Ashok Aggarwal on this, sir. You've heard from the private hospitals. You've also heard from Shaurya's father. Now, you're somebody who's been dealing with patients from the EWS category who have it's a very terrible situation to be in, just to give it a face, to A, be suffering from something like this and then be cash crunched to even treat your child, your spouse, your relatives, whoever it might be. What does one do in this situation? If today somebody goes to a hospital, and not EWS, because I understand if you have a BPL card, you get other waivers. If you do not have a BPL card, which is also more than 50% of the population, which still can't afford very good medical health care, what is the way forward for them?
You see, health care in our country is facing lot of problems, multiple problems. Essentially, it has become a necessity. because of default of the government to improve their government's hospitals. Now 83-84% is catered by the private hospitals.
And what can they do?
No, one thing is that there is a lack of regulation. We have no regulation. I don't know under what provisions of law the government, even after they found that this hospital was negligent or making extra money, what action they can take under what law, I don't know. There is no law according to me. And there is a need to of law. There is no public health right in this country. If you go to the court and say that direct the AIIMS to provide me free treatment, they will say sorry.
Our hands are tied.
That is the problem. So the private hospital has become a necessity. What is required is, I think primarily what is required is to address this issue is that like Right to Education Act, the right to public health should be brought in the concurrent list, number one. Second, it should be made the fundamental right, and then there should be a national law about this. Why 40-45% people coming from neighboring states to Delhi?
But sir, I just want to highlight this point here. While we've been talking about the fact that it's the problem of the masses, it's not just that. In fact, we have somebody on the phone line with us, and we'll try to go to him in a bit. Former Rajya Sabha MP, Mr. M.A. Khan, had raised this issue in the parliament that he, in his sitting capacity of an MP, when he was a member of parliament, was also, what he calls, was fleeced. His wife went to the hospital for a diarrhea case, and she was charged, overcharged, and done, numerous tests were done on her when it was just not required. So this is happening to everybody. Before I go to M.A. Khan, I want to bring in the IMA chief here. Doctor, what can be done in cases like these? Because again, I just want to highlight, I'm not trying to put Medanta or Fortis in the dock here, or I don't want them to feel the burden. But
I want to answer a couple of things.
Yeah.
One, a small request to all the channels. Let's not do the postmortem of any medical case if the inquiry is going on. That's not allowed. And Dr. Tehan, Dr. Jagdish Shiva are not supposed to speak anything about the case.
No, the inquiry, I did not ask them about the case. Let me just check with them. I did not ask them about the case. I just asked them what was the way forward. I'm just correcting you there.
They are not supposed to speak if the matter is in the court. Because they are not.
So, Acharya's case is not in the court as well?
No, inquiries are going on. No? What are the cases?
Inquiries.
The inquiries are going on, we are not supposed to speak.
Okay.
So, therefore, I will not comment as the IMA chief.
So, I ask
following
you, what's the way forward?
I'm coming to that. I'm just putting it on it because all the channels are now doing the job of a medical expert. So, therefore, I'm requesting all the channels not to do that. Let it be done by the inquiry. When the inquiry report comes, then we do the postmortem. That's one. Second thing is, we need to understand that. First of all, both the hospitals, the Medanta and the Fortis, I am disturbed because those people have gone to the channels. Even now, one of the person is attending to the channels. It's the duty of the hospitals to have their own grievance cell. In every death, it's their duty to call them. Every death, there should be a death audit. That's the IMA requirement. In the death audit, they are supposed to find a person, an outsider as a chairman, and they are going to call the family that this death has occurred. We have fixed up this time to answer all your queries. This should be a routine. Patient satisfaction, relation satisfaction has to be a routine.
Important.
If they have not gone.
Important point.
Suppose if you call them and they don't come, then you have a defense in the media that we have called them.
I actually agree with you on that. That why do they need to come to channels at all? They should be able to do this internally. I'm sorry, sir. I have to take a break there. I'm sorry, I'm getting reminders. I have to take a break. On the other side, I just want to take concluding comments from everyone to try and understand. We are not, let me just clarify, we are not like every other channel trying to put you in a kadghara and ask you questions. We are just raising very legitimate questions and trying to understand the story from both the sides. Let's slip into a short break now. On the other side, we'll bring you more on what can you do. If tomorrow it's you and your child caught up in that hospital, what is the way forward? Come back on the other side. Welcome back to discussing is the medical healthcare system in the country in a state of emergency. Dr. Aggarwal, I want to start with you. You were making a very important point earlier on that it is, I mean, while everybody is making and everybody is open to making these wild allegations at some people calling it wild allegations at the private hospitals, that's not entirely the case.
But some of the hospitals have to be at the level of Singapore Hospital. UK hospitals and US hospitals.
Hmm.
And there will not be more than 10 in a city, 7 or 8 or 10 in a city. Their cost, you need to compare how much money we are saving, otherwise these people could have gone to UK or to US. So in a UK or in US, the cost of an intensive care unit with the type of facilities they are providing will not be less than £4,000 to £5,000 a day.
Hmm.
And the first day charges will always be double. And there is always a difference, a person who survives and a person who doesn't survive.
Hmm.
The person who doesn't survive, that means he is critically ill, his bill will be 1.5 times than the bill of a person who survives.
That's a very important point in perspective.
So therefore you cannot, the message should not go to the community that 1 lakh rupees a bill in a day is cheating, is sleazy. Because what will happen is, if these types of hospitals close this type of a facility, which is not available in the government, where will the people go? Will you spend like in Nirbhaya case a crore rupees to send the patient to Singapore? No, people won't be able to afford.
I find that point quite interesting. But Dr. Aggarwal, also the case is, today we've reported on the case of the Shiva Hospital, where the girl was groped inside. There are two male people who are targeting. This is also a hard reality of the private healthcare sector.
Yes, that's right. Lot of malpractices are also going on. I can number maybe more than 100 malpractices going on. That has to be addressed. I think legally they need to be addressed.
All right.
And you see, in Delhi, we have been able to identify at least 45 private hospitals, big one, on the government land, which were allotted land on a throwaway prices.
Hmm.
And those who are supposed to provide at least 10% IPD and 25% OPD to the patient belonging to economically
weak
persons.
All right,
it is not happening.
Hmm.
We have to fight like anything. And that has, the lands were allotted in 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s. And it becomes
right.
a little bit reality only now.
Hmm.
So something somewhere is very seriously wrong, which is need to be addressed.
Very important point there, sir, and thank you. I'm sorry I'm short of time, so I have to cut it there. But I just want to end by saying that, as you rightly said, there is more needs to be done both in the public and the private healthcare system. This is a debate which requires much more time, but we'll try and get back to that in later on. For now, thank you so much for watching, and stay tuned to NDTV.